ओके, सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। वी विल स्टार्ट आवर क्लास टुडे। सो इज इट ऑडिबल? एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू ऑल? ओके, सो देर मे बी सम प्रॉब्लम, वी हैव कनेक्टेड थ्रू फोन, देर वॉज सम टेक्निकल इशूज। एनी हाउ, सो टुडे आवर टॉपिक विल बी एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ हिप जॉइंट। Although we should have taken this class bedside ideally, but because of the ongoing conditions, we'll see how much you will see how much you can learn from this. What? Okay, we'll try to explain through PPT. So before we go deep into hip examination, it is one of the very important joint. From orthopedics point of view, nearly 50% of you will get case in exam from hip examination and hip pathology. So you must be very thorough with this examination. It's little bit lengthy, and you will be coming across many technical terms. There will be lot many tests. There will be lot many measurements. There will be lot many new terms, but gradually with time you will become familiar and you will be able to understand. So before going into examination, I'll just refresh your anatomical knowledge about hip. So it's a type of ball and socket joint, you all know that. It connects the pelvic girdle with lower limb. It consists of femoral head and acetabulum. So it is designed for stability and wide range of movement. Okay, it is covered with the thin layer of hyaline cartilage. Then this articular surface of hip joint is horseshoe shaped. You can see it's not completely circular, it's just like horseshoe, and it is deficient inferiorly. Here the articular surface is deficient. Okay, it has a labrum. It has a labrum. Okay, this part is called the labrum. In the outer part of this cavity, so it functions to make the joint more deeper. Okay, it bulges outward so that it makes the cavity much more deeper. So what are the various ligaments you must be knowing? It's from the anterior side, it's iliofemoral ligament. It connects pelvis to femur. It resembles a Y shape, stabilizes the hip by limiting hyperextension. Then other ligaments are ischiofemoral ligament. It is on the posterior aspect. Then this is pubofemoral ligament. It attaches to the pubis to the femur. Okay. Lightly, there are other ligaments also: transverse acetabular ligament, ligament of head of femur. So these all ligament, they function to support the hip joint and its complex movements. So this is overview of how a hip joint will look. There will be anterior superior leg spine, iliopubic eminence, acetabular labrum. Overall, this is the anatomy of the hip joint. So we'll not go very deep into it. What are the muscles? You all know: gluteus maximus, minimus, medius. Okay, and individual functions you might be also knowing. Quadriceps muscles, they are also present. They are present. Okay, iliopsoas, hamstrings on the posterior aspect. Okay, so these are functions of the muscles basically. Flexors, you have iliopsoas, sartorius, TFL and rectus femoris. Extensors, you have hamstring, adductor magnus, gluteus maximus, and subsequently adductors are adductor longus, brevis, magnus, gracilis and pectineus. Similar way, there are abductors, there are external rotators, there are internal. So all these a group of muscle, they function together and help in different types of movement. Nerves, you know, femoral nerve, obturator nerve, sciatic nerve. Then blood supply of femoral head, it is important. Sometimes it comes as a theory question too. So as you can see, there is branch of obturator artery, lateral femoral circumflex artery, medial femoral circumflex artery. Okay. So now this was overall, this was about the anatomy of hip joint. So now we will come to examination. So basically the examination, it divided into these 8 categories. Okay, broadly, in detail we will go one by one. First it comes history, then we get to general examination. Hello. मेरा थोड़ा टाइम लगेगा, 12 बजे. सर लोग नहीं है क्या, उनको दिखा दो. ठीक, मैं आके देख लूंगा अगर मतलब क्लियर है ना 12 बजे तक. ठीक है. हाँ तो फिर ठीक है. ठीक. सो आई एम सॉरी अबाउट दैट. So we'll go to gait, then we'll have inspection, then we'll have palpation, movements, measurements, special test. So these are the broad headings in which examination of hip joint will be conducted. So we'll go into the detail one by one. So what are the clinical features of hip pathology? As we all know, pain is the first and foremost complaint in each and every time. It is very important, chief complaint of orthopedics. Then we can have swelling, we can have loss of function, we can have limp, we can have leg length discrepancy. This is a term, I will explain it in coming slides or maybe later. What is this limb length discrepancy? So we'll focus on pain. So we can have pain in anterior side of hip, we can have in lateral side of hip, we can have pain in the posterior side of hip. Each of the site has its own importance. Like anterior hip pain, we can have arthritis and these all diseases, labral tear, iliopsoas bursitis. In lateral hip pain, we can have greater trochanter bursitis, gluteus maximus. So the pain, we can localize the pain mostly in 3 regions: anterior hip pain, lateral hip pain and posterior hip pain. Okay, so how you will extract the information about pain? So you might be thorough with history taking. You all know what are the criteria in which the history of pain is taken with special reference to. If you say orthopedics, then you will have few extra things, otherwise the rest is all common. Onset, yes, you will say onset. Then you will have character. Suppose the pain is very sharp and you can suspect there may be muscle tear or fracture. If the pain is dull, you can say it is maybe there, it may be osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis. Throbbing pain, you get in infections. Then you can have radiating pain, you find in sciatica, and you also, of course, in hernia. We are not concerned about inguinal hernia or Brunson, but you still get radiating pain in those cases also. Next, you will ask for diurnal variation. So night cries is something you find in tuberculosis. Some of you might be knowing what is night cries. Night cries is pain is so intense, so much pain that patient will wake up from sleep at night. So that pain we call it night cries. You usually found in tuberculosis. Then if the pain is associated with morning stiffness, you can suspect inflammatory disease, ankylosing spondylitis and rheumatoid arthritis. So, for every character, they will help you to diagnose, they will lead you towards a particular diagnosis. So, you must know what I should ask and why, what I should not, and what are the things that patient will tell. It will help you to guide towards your diagnosis. Referred pain in hip pathology, pain can be referred up to knee. So sometimes you will find patient, they will complain of pain in knee, but they will have pathology in hip. So you can have knee pain even in hip pathology. You must remember that. Now the pain can also originate from spine. Okay, so sometimes we get pain over anterolateral region of thigh. So if you are seeing someone pain in the anterolateral region of thigh, you can also suspect that the lesion may be in spine, because due to spine also the pain can come to anterolateral aspect of thigh. Okay, there can be pain over the back of thigh. Okay, while the pain on the anterior aspect of thigh mainly originates from the hip joint, but you must also know that the pain can also come from spine. Now, what were they doing when the pain came on? Okay, how the pain originated? Did they fall? So if they will say you the history of fall, you may suspect there may be fracture, there may be muscle tear, there may be some hematomas or something. Okay, while if they say they were the pain started while playing some sports, there may be muscle sprain or some ligament tear or labral tear. Or they may say they have history of prolonged history, then you can suspect osteoarthritis. Okay, so these are the things which will help you differentiate between different pathologies of hip. Now, next you will ask what are the aggravating and relieving factors. So obviously osteoarthritis get worse as the day goes on and is relieved by rest, but muscle tear sprains, they are aggravated by movement, while rheumatoid arthritis is worst after prolonged period of rest. So these are the things you will ask from the patient. What are the relieving factors? Suppose they say after taking rest they feel better, you can suspect osteoarthritis. But if they are saying that after the rest the pain is more severe, you can suspect they may have rheumatoid arthritis. Now coming to swelling, swelling is almost, you are quite familiar with swelling. You have learned in surgery. You will have site onset, duration associated with pain, progression with time. Okay, we won't discuss swelling in detail. So now coming to limp. What do you mean by limp? So limp is something, it's usually noticed by others, not the patient himself, that he is walking abnormally or there is limping. So this will be noticed mostly by the relatives. So you will ask about duration associated with pain. Sometimes you in TB hip, limp appears before pain. Usually pain is first complaint, but sometimes you can have limp even before pain. So these are some conditions where you will get painless limp, congenital developmental dysplasia of hip, coxa vara, healed infection with ankylosis, neuromuscular disorders like poliomyelitis and cerebral palsy. So sometimes you are asked, if you are asked about limping, they will ask name some condition where you find painless limp. So in that case you can just answer these. So how the limp progressed, what was the ambulatory status? Now coming to past history. So past history is important. You will ask about trauma, you will ask about tuberculosis, you will ask about surgery around hip, other skin hematological disorders, neurological disorders, steroid intake, मैं अदर कोमॉर्बिड कंडीशन डायबिटीज मेलाइटस हाइपरटेंशन एक्सेट्रा ओके यू ऑल नो दैट पर्सनल हिस्ट्री यू लास्क अबाउट यू ऑल्सो नो ऑक्यूपेशन वर्क टॉलरेंस डाइट स्मोकिंग देयर मेनोपॉजल हिस्ट्री ओके सो यू विल हैव पर्सनल हिस्ट्री यू विल ऑल्सो आस्क फैमिली हिस्ट्री यू विल आस्क फॉर ट्यूबरकुलोसिस यू विल आस्क फॉर मेटाबॉलिक स्टोरेज डिसऑर्डर्स यू आस्क फॉर इन्फ्लामेटरी आर्थराइटिस कॉज इट कॉमनली रन्स इन फैमिली इफ समवन हैज देन यू मोर लाइकली दैट देयर चिल्ड्रंस और देयर ये विल गेट दोज कंडीशन सो नाउ कमिंग टू जनरल एग्जामिनेशन जनरल एग्जामिनेशन ऑल्सो आई विल नॉट गो इन टू डिटेल यू ऑल नो वट ऑल यू विल आस्क फीवर वाइटल्स क्लबिंग पैलर पेडलिडम लिम्फेडनोपैथी चेस्ट एक्सपेंस ऑल दिस जनरल एग्जामिनेशन यू ऑल नो वेरी वेल Now coming to local examination that is much more important for our point of view. So what is the prerequisite? You should properly expose a patient just below from the nipples to the lower part. Everything should be exposed so that you can examine the hip joint properly. Not that if you are examining the hip, only the hip will be exposed. You have to expose him from the level of GP sternum or from the level of nipples to below. So first we'll go to inspection. Am I properly audible or is there any problem with hearing? Someone just can write if I'm audible properly. Okay. So now inspection will first will see the patient. Inspection means what we have to see the patient. So you will inspect a patient from front, from side, and from back. Okay. From three sides you have to inspect the patient. So what we'll look from the front level of shoulder we'll see the level of shoulder there may be drooping of some if there is hip deformity there are compensatory mechanisms and sometimes you will get both shoulders are not at same level so you have to comment on the level of shoulder that both the level of shoulder are at the same level or if any shoulder is at a lower level you can say that left or right shoulder is slightly below appears to be slightly below than the other one okay then you can see the wasting of quadriceps so you will see the limb from forward you can in the figure you can see that one of the limb is slightly wasted this limb is slightly wasted So by inspection you can say that this is slightly thinner than this one so you can say there is wasting of this limb What more thing you will see the alignment of lower limbs whether toes are in toeing or toes are out toeing okay this one is in toeing toe you can see So there may be visible swelling like cold abscess, lipoma. You can see visible swelling near the hip. There may be scars. There may be dilated veins, discoloration of the skin. So now, basically, from front side, you will just observe the patient. First, you will see the level of shoulder. Then you will go down. Then you will see whether the thigh. And they are wasted. Whether there are any scar marks present. Whether there are visible swelling. Whether the toes are properly present or not. Now from the side, just don't try to mug up all the thing. Just put in your mind what all things you will do. Just try to imagine a patient. Any patient is standing before you, and what can you see from front okay just try to imagine what all structures should be visible from front side then we'll try to imagine what all structures will be visible from side so once we go towards the side, if we look a patient from sidewards, what we'll see? We can see the attitude of hip, knee and ankle. So we can see, are they in one line or the knee is slightly flexed, it is bent. This we can see from sidewards. Secondly, we can see the lumbar lordosis. So we can see if, whether the spine is exaggeratedly more bent with its usual curve, whether it is normal or is it abnormal. Okay, there can, you can see trochanteric prominence sidewards, there is a greater trochanter, you can feel on the side, one side of your hip. So the most prominent part is greater trochanter. So sometimes those part are more, they become more prominent in malunited fractures of trochanter. You find very broad trochanter as compared to opposite side. So we can get trochanteric prominence there. Then you can find scars of previous surgery. Then you can find the knee, whether it is fixed posture of knee, whether it is bent or not. So these all we'll see from the side. So now coming from backside, what we'll observe from the backside, you can find the scoliosis of the, you can see the scoliosis of the, you can see the figure. First one is the normal spine. So this second one is the scoliotic spine. This is somewhat bent towards its right side, convexity is towards this side. So you can see from backside whether his or her spine is normal or it is looking abnormal. So here one, just remember, there is a test called Adams test. So scoliosis can be functional or it can be structural. Structural means there may be a structural deformity in the spine. There may be structurally some problem, either with the problem of vertebra or some disc spaces or something. So there will be structural problem. But functional scoliosis means there is no abnormality over the vertebras or something, but just to accommodate the hip, so the spine may be slightly bent. So there is a test called Adams test. So you ask the patient to bend forward. If after bending forward the scoliosis disappears, then that is functional scoliosis. But if the deformity persists even after bending forward, then you definitely, you get sure that you have structural scoliosis. Okay, so this is just forward bending test or Adams test to differentiate between structural and functional scoliosis. So just don't think that we are examining about, we are learning examination of the hip, but we are I'm saying you about spine. So both are very much interlinked, and gradually I will say you how the deformities in hip, they can be reflected in spine. Okay, so still there are more things from back. Alignment of lower limbs, scars, calf atrophy, there may be atrophy of calves, atrophy. Here you can see there is atrophy of this limb. So the all these you will see in your inspectory findings. You will also see gluteal folds, whether the gluteal folds are symmetrical, there may be gluteal wasting, muscle wasting. So you can see those from the inspection itself. There may be hamstring atrophy. Okay, so there is one more thing you will see from back, that is known as Trendelenburg sign. So this sign is seen in the weakness of abductors of hip. This you have to remember, what why Trendelenburg sign is seen. It is due to weakness of abductors of hip. So what are the abductors of you? Gluteus medius and minimus. So when the person, if a hip is, suppose one hip is affected, so when the person stands on the affected hip, the pelvis tilts to the contralateral side. Now what does this mean? So normally, in a normal person, if you ask to stand from one leg, okay, just try to imagine, just because we are not having direct patient here, so all I can say is you can imagine in front of you that someone is standing in front of you, ask him or her to lift her leg, one of the leg. So usually what happens, the side which you are lifting your leg, okay, the pelvis will be shifted upward, okay. This is normal phenomena. If the hip is normal in which we are standing, so the pelvis will go upward toward over the leg that is lifted, okay. This is normal. But when there is weakness of abductors, and we will ask the patient to stand in that leg, in that pathological hip, the leg with pathological hip, and there is weakness over the abductors on that side, then the pelvis, opposite side pelvis, which used to get elevated in a normal hip, this time it will not get elevated, but it will come down. So why does this happen? Because the abductors, they act in the opposite side. They help the pelvis to lift it, lift the opposite side of the pelvis upwards. So if they will be weakened, they will not be able to lift the hip. So the pelvis will be coming down in the opposite side. Is it clear what is Trendelenburg sign? It is very important. You will be asked Trendelenburg sign. There is a Trendelenburg test also. We'll coming to that later. Both things are different. Sometimes students get confused over them, and the examiner, they keep confusing them. What is Trendelenburg sign? What is Trendelenburg test? So gradually we will come to that test in special test. Okay. So these are all the inspectory things. First, you are seeing the patient in standing position. In standing, you will see from front, you will see from side, you will see from back. Okay. Then again, we'll see what is gait. It also comes under inspection. So a defined gait, if you are asked, you can say it is a rhythmical bipedal biphasic walking in which lumbar spine, hip and legs move in unison. They move simultaneously. So this is the exact definition of gait, or in layman term, if you will say what is gait, then you can say it is a way of walking. How a person walks, we call it gait. So limping is the most common abnormality, can be defined as an abnormality of rhythmical normal biphasic walking. So we need not go to very detail, but I will say you about what are the phases of gait, because they have their importance. So you have two phases in gait. One is stance phase, one is swing phase. Stance means when the foot is on the ground, swing is when it is in the air. And the stance phase is again divided into, number one is heel strike. While walking, first your heel comes in contact with the ground, so heel strike. Second is early flat foot. Now the feet becomes flat, so it is early flat foot. Now in the late flat foot, you slightly try to raise your heel, okay. Then last one is toe off. Okay, so these are the phases of gait, heel strike, flat foot, and toe off. Stance phase, swing phase. Okay, so now we'll see what are the different types of abnormal gait. First, after you inspect a patient from all the three sides, then you, if the patient is able to walk, you ask him to walk and you see whether there is any abnormality in the gait of the person. You find different types of gait in different clinical settings. We'll see what are those. One is antalgic gait, Trendelenburg gait, waddling gait, circumduction gait, gluteus maximus gait, high stepping gait. So what do you mean by antalgic gait? So in painful condition, when the hip is sometimes very much painful, so a patient will try to put pressure on that limb for minimal time. So suddenly they will put their leg over the ground, then they will lift it as soon as possible so that they get less pain. So that is known as antalgic gait. So technically, if you will say, the stance phase is reduced. So he is keeping his leg over the ground for less period of time. So the stance phase has decreased. If it would have been in clinical class, I would have shown you how people walk in antalgic gait. But this is how antalgic gait. It is painful. When the hip is painful, you will see antalgic gait. Now coming to Trendelenburg gait. So this is the Trendelenburg gait. So it is seen when there is weakness of abductor muscles, as I had told you, Trendelenburg sign. So there is weakness of abductor muscles. Here you can see the contralateral pelvis, the pelvis which is not affected, it is coming down. In a normal, if this hip was normal, in which my cursor is pointing, this opposite pelvis should come upwards, should come here while normal walking. But in Trendelenburg gait, this contralateral hip, it will be coming down. Okay, so the lurch is towards the affected side. This hip is affected and the lurches will happen in this side of the body. Okay, so this is Trendelenburg gait. When you find free time, you can search in YouTube how what is Trendelenburg gait, then you will appreciate better. If you will see the video, you will appreciate better what is Trendelenburg. Now this is waddling gait. If both abductors of hip are paralyzed, the patient bends his trunk towards the stance phase. He will bend and he will walk. This is waddling gait. Circumduction gait, as the name suggests, the patient rotates the hip sidewise during swing phase. Okay, so this is how a circumduction, he will make a half circle, nearly a semicircle from his leg. This is circumduction gait. Now gluteus maximus gait, if paralyzed posterior tilting, and the person nearly falls towards back. Okay, so this is a type of gluteus maximus gait. High stepping gait, you find in foot drop. Okay, just if you stand in one place and if you do right left and raise your foot, then that is how you say that is high stepping gait. Okay, some of you, those who have done parade or something in your school days, you might know that somehow a high stepping gait is like that. So the when it will be affected, patient will lift the leg very high. Now all those inspection you did, first you did in standing position from all three sides, then you inspected what is the gait of patient. Now you will examine the patient in lying position, or you will inspect the patient in lying down position. So what you will कमेंट ऑन द ये यू विल कमेंट ऑन द एटीट्यूड ऑफ द पेशेंट, हाउ ए पेशेंट इज प्लेस्ड ओवर द काउच. सो दिस इज अ डेवलपमेंटल डिजीज, डेवलपमेंटल डिसप्लेसिया ऑफ हिप. यू फाइंड पेरिनियम इज वाइडेंड, ओके, देर इज डुप्लीकेशन ऑफ ग्लूटियल फोल्ड, यू कैन फाइंड योर ग्लूटियल फोल्ड पोस्टीरियरली. दिस यू विल सी इन इंस्पेक्शन. Now, what other things you will do? Suppose there is synovitis of hip, you will find fever, mild flexion, abduction, external rotation. In arthritis, you will find flexion, adduction, internal rotation. So this you have to remember, what are the position of limb in synovitis, in arthritis, in posterior dislocation. Okay, so this is how a posterior dislocation will look. It will, the hip will be placed in. This hip is in flexion, mark adduction, it is moving towards inside, so it is adduction, and it is internally rotated. Okay, so these are different types of attitude you will find in lying down position, and with related to different diseases or different conditions, you will observe that the attitude of limb is different. Anterior dislocation, you will have different attitude. Intracanteric hip fracture, there will be marked external rotation. Okay, if there is trochanteric fracture of the hip, your foot, if you keep patient will be in lying down patient position, the foot will be totally rotated laterally such that your little toe will touch the couch. Okay, just try to imagine what I am saying. Think that you are lying down on a bed or something, and you get trochanteric fracture. Then your leg will fully rotated outward laterally, and the smallest toe, it will touch the couch or the bed. Normally, our foot is upright, but in trochanteric fracture, it will fully rotate and it will touch the couch. So this is characteristic feature of trochanteric fracture. In neck femur fracture also you get externally rotated, but just because the neck femur is intracapsular, so the external rotation will be less as compared to trochanteric fracture. In trochanteric fracture, the leg will be fully rotated, it will touch to the your lateral border of your foot will touch the couch. So that is clear cut diagnosis for trochanteric fracture. Even before x-ray you can say then that this is the case of trochanteric fracture. Okay, now what all you will see in lying down position, you go from side, you look lumbar lordosis. This is the lumbar lordosis. Okay, so slight amount of lordosis is normally present, but in cases of hip you may have exaggerated lumbar lordosis. Okay, this gap that you are seeing here, this gap may become very big. Okay, anterior superior iliac spine are at level or not. So this is somewhere anterior superior iliac spine. So from side if you look, you can know that whether they are at same level or then the greater trochanter position and prominence. So somewhere here you will find greater trochanter. So whether it is in position, whether it is more prominent or something, you can say from in lying down position. Now coming to Scarpa's triangle, okay. You will find the fullness scars. First of all, what is scarpa? Can anyone say what is Scarpa's triangle? Hmm? What are the boundaries of Scarpa triangle? Can anyone remember and say? Yeah, it's femoral triangle. And the boundaries, what are the boundaries? Medial border is formed by? Adductor longus, and it is which border of adductor longus? Medial border of adductor longus. Okay, sometimes you get confused that it is in the medial side, so the border is the lateral border of adductor magnus, but actually it is medial border of adductor longus and laterally sartorius, and the base is formed by inguinal ligament. Okay, so your very neurovascular structures you get. So you will be asked sometimes what is Scarpa triangle and what are the boundaries. You are frequently asked in orthopedics also. So you will feel the full, you will see whether it is looking fullness or whether there is any scar or something. Till now we have not touched the patient. Just remember, we are only inspecting the patient. So we will see the skin, you will see the thigh wasting, you will see important thing, that is position of patella. So normally a patella in lying down position, it slightly points, not exactly perpendicular to the body, but it is slightly rotated outward. So that is usual position of patella. So you have to compare both side, and you have to say that both the patella are facing outward and appears to be at same level. Now you will also see calf wasting, you will see the malleoli level. So whether both the medial malleolus are at same level or there is discrepancy between them. Okay. So these are the thing you will see in the inspection. So where so many things. First, what did we do? First, we inspected the patient in standing position. In standing position, we inspected first from front, then from side, then from posterior aspect. Then we inspected the patient in lying down position. We commented about levels of shoulder, levels of anterior superior iliac spine. Okay, so all these these are our observational findings. What we are looking before going to palpation, you have to mention one sentence that every examiner will like to hear, that all my inspectory findings were confirmed by palpation. So this sentence is must for everyone. Before going to palpation, you have to say this sentence, that all my inspectory findings were confirmed by palpation. Okay, so in palpation, first what you will see, you will touch and you will see temperature, whether it is normal or whether you find the temperature is raised. So you find raised in acute arthritis, you may find raised in temperature. Then you will palpate greater trochanter. So here is where you find greater trochanter. You will palpate whether there is broadening, thickening, tenderness or displacement. Okay. Now coming to palpation of tenderness, where you will palpate for tenderness for hip joint, anteriorly 2 cm and lateral to 2 cm below and lateral to mid inguinal point. You will mark, you will know what is the extension of inguinal ligament. So, and you will mark mid inguinal point, from there 2 cm below and lateral, you will palpate for any tenderness for hip joint. Okay. Then you will palpate for lateral hip pain. You have to put pressure over greater trochanter. Usually we do with both of our hands, with our both hands, we will try to push from greater, or you can say we will try to squeeze the patient by placing our hand in trochanter, in greater trochanter area. Okay, so we can have pain if there is pain over slight touching, then you can say there is fresh trochanteric fracture. If there is deep pressure tenderness, you can say there is healing trochanteric fracture. If there is something called thrust tenderness, we give a thrust, we give a punch, then this you find in neck femur fracture or acetabulum fracture or in TB. Okay. Now coming to posterior side of palpation, how, what will, at what point we will palpate for tenderness? At the junction of lateral one-third and medial two-third of the line connecting posterior superior iliac spine and greater trochanter. Okay. So there are a lot of theoretical things. You have to remember them. There is no other way. Initially you will find it difficult, but gradually once while you're ward posting, you revise again and again, then you will get through it till your exam. So posteriorly, this is the point where you will palpate for tenderness. Lateral one-third, medial two-third of line joining PSIS and greater trochanter. And we'll sign, I'll not teach you, it's not very important for your point. So this is this representation where you will find anterior joint tenderness here. This is 2 cm below and lateral to mid inguinal point. Examiner asks you where you will assess for tenderness from anterior side. You have to mention this point. This is trochanteric tenderness, and this is medial joint tenderness. This is called something called different along the adductor. If you will try to palpate, this is medial joint tenderness. Okay. Anterior, trochanteric, medial, and posterior. I told you the line joining PSIS and greater trochanter. So now you might be very much confused about what is ASIS, what is PSIS, where I will palpate ASIS, where I will palpate PSIS. So anterior superior iliac spine, where do you will find? You will put your hand over the inguinal, over the area of inguinal ligament from medial to lateral, and you will keep moving your thumb from medial to lateral side. So when you will find first bony prominence, that is anterior superior iliac spine. Okay. For greater trochanter, you will slide your, this is for the greater trochanter, you will slide your finger from the femur sap. You can palpate the femur very easily here. From here you will keep palpating and going proximally till it is obstructed. Here you will find a obstruction, a bony tip you will find. This is actually tip of greater trochanter, so you now know that this area is the greater trochanter. Okay. Now ischial tuberosity, it is also one of the important landmark. In thin patient it is comparatively easier, in more fat persons you will find it difficult. So you have to palpate deeply from the midline of the gluteal fold and mark the most prominent. Somewhere here if you will try to palpate deeply, you will find ischial tuberosity. Now posterior superior iliac spine is palpated just over the dimple of venous. These two are dimple of venous, we call it dimple of venous. So just over here you will find posterior superior iliac spine. Now sacroiliac joint, that is not very much important. So this is how you know. Now you know how to palpate anterior superior iliac spine, how to palpate posterior superior iliac spine, how to palpate ischial tuberosity. Now one more thing you will mark, you have to mark all these things, you have to mark with your pen when you are examining of a patient. Okay. You have to take a marker and you have to mark where is ASIS, where is PSIS. Now one more thing you will mark is medial joint line. What is medial joint line? The joint between tibia and femur. So where you will find? Slide your fingers upwards over the medial surface of the medial condyle tibia. Okay. So from the medial surface of tibia you will palpate it, above above above, you will reach here tibia condyle, then you will find a slight depression clinically. So this will be joint line. So this is the actual position of the joint. Medial malleolus, of course, it is very much prominent. You won't be having problem in palpating medial malleolus. Slide, you will slide your finger and you will find in the medial side, and one bony prominent is felt, that is medial malleolus. Now there is something called digital Bryant's test. Okay, Bryant's, this is digital, means you have to palpate from finger. There is something other in measurement will come across, that is Bryant's triangle. But that one we have to draw in, we have to mark with pen, but this one we have to do with fingers. Just don't confuse digital Bryant's test. Digital means digits, with finger we have to do this test. Okay, so what you will do, you place the thumb over anterior superior iliac spine. This thumb, you can see in figure, this thumb you will put in anterior superior iliac spine. The hair is somewhere is anterior superior iliac spine. Okay, the middle finger you will put in greater trochanter. There is the middle finger. Here is the middle finger. It has been put in the greater trochanter. Okay, index finger at the intersection of imaginary line perpendicular from ASIS and horizontal line from greater trochanter. Okay, from ASIS. We pull down a perpendicular line straight down, and from greater trochanter we pull horizontally a straight horizontal line. So the line where they intersect, we place the index finger. So this is how we place a digital Bryant's test. What is it used for? It is used for measuring supratrochanteric shortening, means above trochanter how much is the shortening. So between the trochanter and the head of femur, is there some shortening or not, we can know from this palpation. We have to compare from the opposite side. Okay, when I'll explain you about triangle, I will explain it more better, then you will perhaps you can imagine more better. Now you might be saying, how we'll know how what. So once we will know the digital Bryant's triangle, then you can appreciate how what will happen when hypotenuse is shortened, what can be condition when base is shortened, what can be condition when this triangle, all the sides will be shortened. There are different conditions in which different sides will be shortened. Okay, just remember what is Bryant's, what is digital Bryant's triangle. This this first class I am taking just because you will come across the different terms, you will get familiar to them, lots and lot of new terms you will come in contact. So now another very important thing is vascular sign of Narath. You will be asked about this, invariably every one of you will be asked. So we have to see for femoral artery palpation below the mid inguinal point. So if you can palpate the femoral artery pulsation, you say vascular sign of Narath is negative. Okay, just be clear from very first. You will be confused later what is positive, whether if we feel the pulse, whether it is positive or so. Just remember, in normal person, femoral pulse you can palpate, and the vascular sign of Narath is absent. Okay, so when do we say vascular sign of Narath is present? When you can't feel the femoral pulsation. Okay, this happens in posterior dislocation of hip. Why in posterior dislocation of hip we won't be able to palpate the femoral pulse? Can anyone say? Why we can't why we can't feel femoral pulse if there is dislocation of posterior dislocation of hip. Yes, loss of bony. Always wherever you palpate, even in wrist we palpate over radius so that we can feel the pulse. So always we need a bony structure below so that we can feel the pulsation. So here we are having a femoral head below, so we can feel the pulsation of femoral artery. But if the femoral head, it will be dislocated posteriorly, we won't have any bony structure below it, so it will be very difficult for us to feel the pulsation. So in that case we get positive vascular sign, or vascular sign of Narad is positive. We get in posterior dislocation of hip, we get in dissolved head and neck, we can get in Burgess disease. So this you must be very clear about what is vascular sign of Narad, when we'll find it, when we'll not, when it is said positive. Okay, shall I teach further or shall I stop? Because this just I'm telling one more important thing, just I will say superficially, I will next time I will teach it more deeply. It is very important. One is what is fixed deformity. Okay, fixed deformities of hip are persistent posture assumed to avoid pain, to conceal any obvious deformity of the limb length. Okay, when the limb cannot be brought to neutral position. So what is fixed? Fixed means you can understand that static, it has become like that. Deformity is deformity. So as the name suggests, when the deformity is fixed, you said it, say it fixed deformity. So these deformities, they are somewhat their posture assumed by body to conceal. Suppose one of my limb is short, so I will try to conceal that, the body will try to conceal that shortness and it will try to adapt some different positions. So though it leads to fixed deformities. So first and foremost very important thing is fixed flexion deformity. Fixed means fixed, flexion means the hip is flexed. Here you can see the hip is flexed, here it is flexed. So fixed flexion deformity. So in most pathological conditions of hip, the first movement to be lost is extension. You won't be able to extend the hip. Okay, so when you are having, just remember, opposite movements is not possible. Suppose in a fixed flexion deformity, if the limb is fixed in flexion, you can't have extension movement. Okay, this thing you should be very clear that in fixed deformities, the deformity which we have, the opposite movement is not possible. Suppose we have adduction deformity, then we won't have abduction. If it is abduction deformity, we can't have adduction. So the opposite movement is not possible in a fixed deformity. So fixed flexion deformity, obviously extension is not possible, but there can have flexion. Okay, if the hip has fixed flexion deformity, flexion, further flexion movement can be possible, but extension movement is never possible. Just you have to remember it, that opposite movement is not possible. So the fixed flexion deformity at the hip, so here is the fixed flexion deformity of hip. So it is compensated by lumbar lordosis. So as I had said you, the deformities of hip are concealed by the lumbar lordosis. So it will exaggerate more and it will try to compensate the deformity which has happened in the hip. So there is a test, very important test, Thomas test. It was done by Hugh Govind Thomas first time, so it is named after him. So this is also one of the thing invariably every one of you will be asked about Thomas test. Very, very important test. So it is a test used to measure fixed flexion deformity for unilateral cases. You have to remember that only if one hip is affected you can do this test. If both hip are simultaneously affected by a person, you can't do this test. This is a limitation for this test. So patient lies in supine position. Okay, here is a patient. He is lying in supine position. The examiner stands on the right side of the patient with one hand under the lumbar spine. Okay, I will show you the next image. So this, the examiner puts one of his hand over the lumbar lordosis area. Okay, this one, and he pushes this normal limb. This hip is normal. Okay, he will try to push this hip downwards towards the belly. Okay, here you can see he is pushing the hip towards the belly. Now so this unaffected knee is fully flexed. This is unaffected knee. This one is the unaffected knee. It is fully flexed till this lumbar lordosis is removed, till you can no longer put your hand below this lordosis. Okay, a point will come where you will no longer be able to put your hand through that lordosis. This will be obliterated. This gap which you find in lumbar, it will be obliterated. Till that time comes, you have to push this normal limb over the belly. So now if the patient has fixed flexion deformity, this hip will be in this angle. So this angle is called the fixed flexion deformity. Laga raha hu na 5 minute mein class. So this angle which the hip, horizontal hip or the thigh it forms with the couch, we called it fixed flexion deformity. You can try in yourself. In a normal person, even if you put this opposite limb or both the normal limb, if you try to press towards your belly, this part of yours will be fully a straight line. It won't be raised like this. Okay. So when it is raised like this, this angle is called fixed flexion deformity. I hope you could understand how you will demonstrate. Here is the thing. First you will flex the normal knee and you will push this knee towards the belly and you will try to put a hand over the lordosis. You will keep pushing the knee till you are further not able to put your hands there. Okay, and this leg will form an angle with the horizontal. That will be called Thomas test. This you see, here he is himself doing. He is pulling the normal leg. In first one is the normal case, so you are not getting any angle here. You are not getting any angle with the couch and this limb, but here there is fixed flexion deformity, so the hip is flexing. This is flexion movement of hip. So this angle is fixed flexion deformity. This is Thomas test. So could you understand what is Thomas test, how you will elicit it? It is very important. So I am saying you again and again, in what I will, you can watch YouTube, you can see how it is performed. Better if you see video. Okay, now for bilateral hip, what you will do if both hip are simultaneously affected? You can't be able to like you were flexing the knee of the normal limb, here you won't be able to do the same. So what you will do, you will put the patient over the edge of the table. Okay, So this with the horizontal, the angle it will form, it will be fixed flexion deformity. Okay. This is Thomas test. This is if there is simultaneously fixed deformity of knee also, how you will do? You will put the patient in the edge of the table and you will see that. So these are various methods, these are conditions in which a normal Thomas test can't be done if there is simultaneous affection of knee, if there is simultaneous affection of both the hip. Then you can't do the Thomas test in normal procedure. This was the normal method of Thomas test, which you can't do when simultaneously the knee is affected and both the hip are affected. You have to do different procedures. Okay, this will be asked, if both hip will be affected, how you will do Thomas test? Then you have to say like this. You have to put the patient in prone position over the edge of the table, then we can measure. And if all here you will see, if knee is also having flexion deformity, we'll put the patient in supine position, we will put it in the edge, then we can mark the what is fixed flexion deformity. Okay, other deformities, we have abduction deformity, we'll discuss next time. We have abduction deformity, we have adduction deformity, how we have to measure them, what is squaring of pelvis. Okay, these all we will learn in next class. What are the angle of deformity, what are Kothari's angle, what are the then we'll go to movements, what are the movements of hip joints, what are the normal range. Okay, then we'll have measurement, we'll have bulk, then we have apparent and true length measurement. Okay, then we will have different signs, what is true shortening, what is apparent shortening, what are the conditions, what are the deformities, what are the clinical significance, what is Bryant's triangle, interpretation of Bryant's triangle. So there are a lot more things. Almost we have only just started hip examination. There are other lines, Nelaton line, Shoemaker line, Chinese line, Morris bitrochanteric lines. Okay, so there are a lot more things, supratrochanteric shortening, test for what are the special tests. Okay, so these all we will learn in subsequent classes. So for today we'll stop here. Any part you want me to repeat, or else we'll end the class.